special. Probably a little bit like a Vietnam veteran coming back from war, feeling that they're heroes, but the country just had moved on and not cared, and they didn't win. They weren't winners. And I think very similarly, MPs, life's moved on. We've got another government. Who knows or cares? And they weren't on the winning side. I think that's difficult. Well, I thought we'd start off just getting to know each other a little. And then let's look at the report, and then perhaps we can discuss your CV.
Yes. Before May the 1st last year, I was Member of Parliament for Gillingham, and I had been for almost 14 years.
Self-motivation? You like security?
Well, the last 9 months have been quite insecure.
Yeah? So maybe that's coming out because of that?
Yes. Yeah. It's been a very stressful year, and I show some of the classic signs, including tinnitus. Irritable digestions and things like that, all of those sort of things. I'm 56. Everyone at my sort of age does find it difficult to find another job.
And where were these jobs?
I think being a former Tory Member of Parliament has been a liability rather than an asset.
I think at heart you're a kind person.
Yes,
and
probably.
I think people probably recognise that.
Yes, probably.
Mm-hmm. It's approachable and friendly.
Suddenly, the Conservative Party was not just an opposition, but a small opposition in the House of Commons. And all of that influence in the corridors of power was gone overnight. Therefore, it has been much more difficult.
I mean, these are fabulous skills of chairmanship and coordination.
Well, that's why I keep applying for chairman's jobs.
It would have been nice if the leadership had sought to try to use such influence as it could to support those people who had lost their seats. That was not forthcoming, and one was very much on one's own.
Which was mature before I joined it.
Okay. Your political career, again, it's a listing of parliamentary committees. I'm not sure who cares. So quickly get through this piece and then achievements. Special interests, yes, absolutely. And I think we need to get your networking more. There's no doubt that you will get many, many more ins, more entrees, if you start speaking to people. And I don't think you should.
But I have been speaking to people. From chief executives of FTSE 100 companies through. I mean, contacts in the pharmaceutical industry, which I did a lot of work for a long time.
Right.
But they're walking by on the other side.
Right.
I had not been unemployed since I left college. And I really didn't know where I was going to go or what I was going to do. Politics have been such a part of my life for so long that it was really very difficult to comprehend not being a part of politics and politics being a part of my life.
Of course, there's always comfort and strength in numbers, and we were a party of 8 or 9 people, and we all behaved ourselves entirely perfectly. But it was quite evident that all of this activity in the substantial district of Bangkok...
When you lose your seat, you lose not just your job, but your club, your restaurant, your bar, your friends, your companions, your library, your research services, your whole life. You also lose your authority. You lose those magic letters MP that you can put after your name and be treated with respect wherever you go.
I have been back, and it was very difficult because I was no longer a member of Parliament. Having had the freedom of the place, I found myself entering where the public enters the House, and the whole thing came flooding back. May the 1st and all that had gone before that.
Another batch of applications to make. One there which is unpaid. I don't suppose there'll be quite as many volunteers for that as the paid ones. The lottery fund. Retail marketing and business. Elderly reps. And the director of fitness to practice for the GMC. But they cost a lot of money to put in. And I'm sure that if I apply, we can expect the usual selection of rejection slips. But I thought it was important to keep a log of the jobs I applied for, who they are, what the position was, when the advert was, what the source was. And then we get to the thin columns, first interview, second interview, and the rejection slips. They come pretty regularly. And job offers. 70 applications, no job offers. Most of them are jobs I could do. Very few of them were try-ons. I haven't applied to be managing director of ICI or BAS. Those are jobs I couldn't do. Which job would I most like to have had? Probably a health chairmanship.
Although there was a small charity which I really did fancy being their first chief executive, and I got the silver medal. But there are no silver medals when you're looking for one job.
So what difference has it made to your life?
The lunch thing, I think, which I'm about to do here. When I was on my own, or when Jim was at work, I would grab whatever I felt like, you know, I'd eat a bit of cheese or something. But now, with Jim being home all day, or most days, I find that I've got to think much more about lunch and what he wants and trying to make things, make different things, you know. We have salad, or might have a scrambled egg on toast, or some cold meat and something. What else do we have? Sausages sometimes, when I allow him to have sausages. He shouldn't really have sausages, but just occasionally as a treat. It's got better, I suppose, as time has gone on. It's become easier in some ways, although more difficult in other ways. I think Jim's got quite frustrated. And to be honest, he's bored. I mean, you know, he's worked all his life, never had a day off work. That's it, really. I mean, you know, apart from the fact, you know, it'd be good for him if he was out doing something. I mean, I do feel for him quite strong, you know, very strongly that, you know, he's not terribly happy, I suppose, at the moment, basically, is the problem. Difficult looking into the future, what we are going to do, and trying to plan ahead things. But I'm sure we'll get through it.
MPs don't make a mint, but they're not badly paid. They earn about £43,000. The redundancy package is more generous now than it used to be. It used to be zero. It's now something between £22,000 and £44,000. In other words, something between 6 months and a year's salary.
Retirement wasn't really on the agenda because basically I still need to work, indeed to have an income. My pension will be just under 12,000 at today's prices when I'm 65. I think that if I was to take it now, it would barely be half that figure.
You were part of a
government that presided over a very high level of unemployment. Has the past year made you feel differently about that?
I was always very conscious, as an employer, of the employment market. But yes, of course, being unemployed oneself is a new experience and a very disagreeable one, and one which certainly focuses the mind on the problems which face the unemployed. There are times of great depression about it. I would like to be contributing in some form or another to something gainful and useful. I'm very conscious of being around at home when other people are going out to work. Actually, that's quite a difficult time, the early morning, as other people go to work, and I'm sitting there still reading the newspaper and having breakfast and wondering how I'm going to fill the morning.
A general election, especially a wild landslide, has the effect rather of a receding high tide. Left on the beach are all these things, dead fish, jellyfish, bits and pieces, flotsam and jetsam, bric-a-brac. None of them realised they were going to be left stranded, high and dry, suddenly in the night.
Before May the 1st, I was the Member of Parliament for Gedling and a Minister for Social Security, with specific responsibility for the Child Support Agency. We all knew that there was this huge wall of water coming down on the party, and really it was a question of how far up the beach it would come and how many of us would be swept away.
Coker, Vernon Rodney, 24,300.
I remember standing on the platform as the result was being announced and pinching myself to check this wasn't a nightmare. And afterwards we left the count and drove home. And I will never forget, there at about 4 o'clock in the morning was this fox standing on the corner right in the middle of the Gedling area, washing his whiskers. And I thought to myself, this is a new dawn in Britain. Labour has won by a landslide. And this is now a country where it is safe for urban foxes to come out into the open. There is an aspect of it which is a bit like being dumped by your first girlfriend. And then, of course, what I now have to do is decide whether to try and win her back again, or whether to go off and find a new girlfriend. Being an MP is a bit like being a virgin, in the sense that you either are one or you aren't, and you can't sort of try and pretend you're a bit of one. So I keep away from the House of Commons. Do I miss it? There's a great deal about being a minister which I miss. I miss the camaraderie of the place. I don't think I will ever experience as much fun and enjoyment as I had as a government whip. I used to answer questions on the same day as John Major answered Prime Minister's questions when I was a Social Security Minister. And I used to sit there, sometimes right next door to him, having done my stuff, so I was able to relax, and see this eyeball-to-eyeball confrontation between the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition, which then took place twice a week. And I sit there and I used to think, you know, I am actually getting paid for being here and taking part in all this. It's the best theatre in Britain. It's absolutely terrific, and it's not only free, I'm paid to do it.
Mr. Andrew Mitchell.
Madam Speaker, as you will understand, I do not usually have the pleasure of being joined by so many of my colleagues on both sides of the House when I address this House. And so, faced with this task today, I took myself to the smoking room to seek the advice of a distinguished and senior member of this party. "Don't worry," he said, "you'll be fine. This motion is nearly always proposed by some genial old codger on the way out." and seconded by an oily young man on the make.
To be part of all of that, to have your say, to be part of the club, having a private office who organise everything for you, the sort of quality of the Rolls Royce that whisks you around, so long as you don't let it take you over and develop ministerialitis as a result, is terrific. It was a marvellous experience, and I enjoyed every minute of the 10 years I was there. If you are a minister, you do have real power. And you can change things. And to have that opportunity to change things for the better, I immersed myself in trying to change the Child Support Agency. I made 140 changes while I was a minister for Social Security. And to have that opportunity, if you're really interested in politics and interested in changing things, is a wonderful thing.
I don't think the job that Andrew had, the Child Support Agency, I don't think that helped him latterly, because when we were canvassing in one ward, I knocked on the door of three men who said, no way. Well, one of them particularly, I fetched Andrew back, and he had been paying his dues and demands, but they still wanted more, and I don't think that was a good career move.
No.
So. I quite agree. When I saw Andrew when he was first appointed to the job, I said, well, this will either make you or break
you.
Yeah,
absolutely.
If you make a good job of it, you're a hero.
Absolutely.
But I haven't a lot of hope.
How far do you think you could have gone in politics?
Oh, a long way.
Senior cabinet post. Yeah,
definitely,
yeah.
I'm sure.
I think he was green
cabinet post. Yeah. Well, I think he'd have gone for the top eventually.
It was a standing joke with us, wasn't it? Andrew for Prime Minister.
Yes.
Does it make you feel like a dinosaur?
No, not at all. Not at all. And I think that it will be my generation now who rebuild the Tory party and take it back into government.
All right, Rosie?
Yeah.
I think I do want to go back into politics again, but it's not only a matter for me, it's a matter clearly for my family, my wife and my children, who are shareholders in that decision.
You want me to walk, you want me to run as hard as I can alongside you?
The political career goes up and down, often quite quickly, and no one can tell what the future in politics holds. Clearly, for me personally, May the 1st was a disaster, but when one door shuts, quite often another one opens.
Well done, very good.
So how did you get work?
Well, I literally got on my bicycle and went out and found it. Over the course of the weekend after the election, a lot of my friends from my city days and friends who are in the business world rang up because they were kind enough to be interested in how I was, and offered advice. I mean, no one gives you anything in these circumstances. They give advice and you go and see what you can do. There's no such thing as a free lunch in the city anymore now. But I was hugely helped by 22 people. In fact, I have a list which I carry around with me in my pocket of 22 people who were very helpful to me in the aftermath of the election. I spend a bit of time cycling between my various jobs, calculating how much I'm saving by not taking a taxi. I've got 5 new jobs, and all of them are with companies and with people who are preeminent in their own field of activity. Well, my base is at Lazard's, which is one of London's most respected and successful investment houses. And I'm a director of the Miller Insurance Group, and I'm a strategy advisor to Anderson Consulting and to Boots, and I'm also an advisor to the board of Financial Dynamics.
You
I'm better off now than I was when I was in the House of Commons.
How much better off?
Well, I get paid the rate for the jobs.
Twice as much? Three times as much?
Well, I'm a private citizen, I'm not going to go into that, but I get a fair rate for the job, and I have to perform. If I don't perform, I won't be doing these jobs. I do think I've been very fortunate. I was 40, not 50 or 60. I think if I'd been in my late 50s, I could have been absolutely stuffed.
All right, I must go now. Thank you very much indeed. Many thanks.
A black hole is where a star's gravity is so powerful, nothing can escape.
It's the same principle with the new Hoover Tellius. Its sealed suction system has the filtration power you need to keep more than 99.9% of dust particles locked in. Even particles as small as a grain of pollen. Rely on Hoover to do the homework.
Make me a deal and make it
you know, we're still the land of Meals on Wheels. And in Lancashire, you can still get a great hot pot. Or go to Edinburgh and see the tattoo. And of course, the British male is still not considered as amorous as his Latin counterpart. It's good to know things haven't changed a bit.
Well, I never expected losing. I'm not a loser in life. And I was just shattered.
It was like being present at your own funeral, if that was the word. The letters of condolence that came in.
Before the election, the media were always talking to you, always phoning up. Saturday after the election, no one phoned. No one's phoned since. National media drop you as if you've got BO.
They have what I call this wandering eye syndrome. They will look at you, they'll be charming, then after a few moments their eye will wander away somewhere else.
In truth, you are not the sort of person that people who want to influence government are looking for. They're looking for people with connections into the Labour Party. Better to lose when your party wins than to lose when your party loses as well.
In a sense, the casualties of the last election are being thrown out into a world that they themselves created, a very changed world from the world as it was when many of them went into politics. Jobs are not easy to get, not easy to keep. The professions are much more deregulated. There are no jobs for life, no jobs for the boys, much less jobs through influence than there used to be when the Tories first took office. So they now have, as I suppose their critics would say, a taste of their own medicine.
What we'll do in the session is work just physically for a little while. When you're facing a difficult, or have faced difficult questioning, difficult circumstances, what happens to the breathing?
The breathing goes faster, the breath-taking goes faster anyway.
It's the same for all of us, it's the same for actors. I mean, at RADA, we take 3 years sometimes to try and get somebody to breathe, and it doesn't always work then.
Until last May, I'd been Member of Parliament for Hornchurch for 18 years, and for the last 4 years, I'd been Schools Minister.
It's almost as if all the successful moments, all the people you love, all the people you've worked with, all the people that support you, they are there in your background, yeah? So you could slightly lean back on that. And because it's such a powerful CV, it actually has possibility to move you forwards. Your shoulders don't need to be braced in any way, and as you come up, just leave them to...
A lot of people are made redundant. Quite a few are made compulsory redundant, but very, very few are made publicly compulsory redundant with immediate effect.
And just see if you can find the point of relaxation in that and how that feels. And breathe.
Must remember that.
Okay.
And of course it was clearly true that any employer looking for what they considered to be direct relevant experience of running an outfit would discount, wrongly, ministerial experience. And they'd say, well, when were you last, I mean, doing a real job, Mr. Squire? And of course, we're back to whatever it is, the 1970s.
Well, he's older. Robin is older. He's 56. He's been 18 years in government. He was an accountant, so there's something there. Would he want to go back to being an accountant?
I had no work, and my my sole income after any settlement from the Commons, which you get when you lose your seat, was that I won a brain teaser competition value £20 in the Sunday Times. So there. In the main, I simply got refusals. I applied for two bursar jobs with different schools. Well, you're the accountant of the school, essentially. And was not chosen for either, despite also bringing with me 4 years of experience as a schools minister. But there you go. Time operates totally differently when you're unemployed, because of course in some respects you have all the time in the world, whereas in government ministers would often claim they had no time at all for anything. If you're interested in national politics, Westminster is the only game in town, and one has to adjust that you're not in the only game in town.
In 1492, Christopher Columbus set sail. He wasn't sure where he was going, nor did he find what he was looking for. We know he did find what he wasn't looking for, and he called it something else. 500 years later, the Labour Party leadership set sail, looking for an education policy under Commander Sedgefield and Captain Brightside.
It is difficult to find a better feeling when you know you have changed their mind on a quite important issue, and you've done it on the strength of the argument, on the strength of your personality. That is a wonderful feeling, and it has no ready equal.
I ask the House to reject the opposition motion.
Order, order. When that finish, say aye. 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 No. Division.
I finally signed on in July, and my fourth visit to the office, the cameras arrived and they started taking shots for the employment service, and the guy with the camera said, "Don't I recognise you?" And it turned out that he'd been shooting me 9 months before when I'd been at a major school recognition day in the West Midlands. And so we chatted away quite a bit. I said, "Circumstances change."
Bring us up to date with the reception.
After several months of looking, I was made a director of a lobbying company in October,
and I'm working for them 3 days a week. It involves me assisting them with advice on what are parliamentary and ministerial procedures, and indeed what I know about MPX or MPY. Caterers, aspect all tied up?
That's all fine. I haven't spoken to them about corkage and champagne and things yet.
We need to
But I haven't spoken to Fred about it either.
Well, either you or Fred will need to action that, but assuming they're content and we can, probably not just me, but we'll then need to discuss.
The Tory government of which you were a member was quite ruthless about unemployment levels. Did it make you think again about the policies of the last 18 years?
At the personal level, which is what essentially I'm thinking of, I don't think I would have rerun
many of the decisions and the actions that I took. One of the central strands the government sought to do, not my ministry, but the central strand, was so create a dynamic economy that unemployment would be regularly falling and employment would be rising. And of course, even today, things have continued in that vein, and I welcome that. It just happens that for a time, I was one of the unemployment statistics.
Until the election, I was the Conservative Member of Parliament for Tatton.
I was his wife and secretary, and I'm still his wife.
Martin Bell.
Independent.
29,300.
Well, the curious feature of the declaration of the result was that I didn't really feel anything at all.
I feel now, watching it, strangely detached. I mean, that's all happened in the past, and yes, there we were, key players.
Mostyn Neil Hamilton, 18,000.
It's almost as though it's not me up there.
Well, we couldn't really affect the outcome of this process at the time, and... It was a bit like being a cork bobbing on the water, the tide pushing us in a direction. We had no power to affect either the direction or the speed with which the tide flowed.
I miss the building. I love, love, love Pugin Gothic over the top architecture, and that's why one of the reasons I was so happy there. I don't miss the politics at all.
I went back to the House of Commons to give evidence to the Standards and Privileges Committee, and I surprised myself at the degree of detachment which I felt from the institution.
Let's just look at the various allegations which have been made over the last 4 years by Mr. Fyad against me. They're basically five. First of all, on the 14th of July 1993, Mr. Preston, the editor of The Guardian, first met Mr. Fyad, and he was told about the Ritz Hotel.
How have your ex-colleagues been?
Well, they've not been rushing to the telephone.
Some surprising ones have, actually.
Some have.
Yes,
but
some we might not have expected to.
I'm very disappointed in some people. I'm not going to name them, obviously. But
well, Neil's too hot to handle for some people. They don't want to be associated.
I'm genuinely surprised that some people, some of whom have had a part of the experience, in as much as they've lost their seats, who've not been in touch.
Well, if you've not been used to it, and the awful reality of not having a monthly paycheck, if you've been used to one for so long, and you suddenly hit the buffers and you think, heavens, you know, how are we going to pay the mortgage bill, the milk bill and the gas bill? This year, I'm chopping them all in half, and this coming Christmas, I'm going to send just the front of the card. It's a commendable economy, my mother says. We don't take a daily paper now. My mother, who lives 10 minutes away from us, she takes the Telegraph and she saves it for us. So sometimes, if we're in London for 2 or 3 days, we might see a paper of somebody else's, but we don't buy one. And when we get back home, Granny's got the pile of papers, and they're there. And you'd honestly, the news is just as good 3 days old.
Look at all the trees we're saving.
But that has been a big saving. If you add up, you know, I don't know how much it was, but...
Well, we were spending $1,000 a year on newspapers and magazines. We don't spend that now. And there are lots of other small economies in themselves, but which aggregated amount to a reasonable sum.
Well, I
don't know, people worry a lot when they interview folk about integrity and trust and all of that, and there's a question mark over that with him, right from the beginning. You don't even have to wait for a while to get to know this man, right from the beginning. And he cuts a kind of slightly risible figure in the media. Possibly for the Hamiltons set up in their own business, that's the only way I would have said that he can win his way back to any semblance of a career.
You don't think anyone will give him a job?
Well, it would be a strange job, I think.
There was no time to sit around moping and moaning and feeling sorry for ourselves. We just had to get out there and sell ourselves. To begin with, obviously, there was immense media interest, so we went out and we've ruthlessly exploited that for every penny that it's worth. It was the only means of earning an income. We had to do it if we were to keep a roof over our heads.
What is it we're going to do? I've forgotten.
It's his confessions.
Oh, yes.
Well, never, either of us have never seen it, but they sent a video. It's the one that Simon Mayo hosts.
Oh, goodness me. What could that building be over there? It's the House of Phonies. Look at all those cranes. Do you think they're demolishing it?
Probably
well,
not.
It might as well. It doesn't really do very much, does it? Confessions.
I'm Lisa Norris, I'm a celebrity consultant. Thank you very much for coming on with me today.
Now it's time to play Have I Got Clues For You? And playing tonight we have on my right, from the driving school, it's Maureen Rees and her gallant passenger and husband, Dave. And on my left, the couple who might make the most sensational confession yet. Probably not. It's those veterans of the political punch-up, Neil and Christine Hamilton. In this game, it's questions for cash.
I've done the sort of mainstream breakfast television afternoon shows, late-night chat shows. I've had my experiences with cars over the years, me and money affairs. I just can't, what do I think are the cultural icons of the century? I've just got asked the most extraordinary. I've been asked to review television programmes. I mean, I'm happy to try anything. I don't mind, as long as it's not too intrusive. We've had, a day in the life of Neil and Christine Hamilton, which we did. I can't think what else
we've
been asked.
Well, we've even been asked to review a luxury hotel.
Yes.
I can't think why.
Not the Ritz.
Well, we'll draw the line at that.
Now, we've talked very, very briefly about your plans and maybe to get involved in broadcasting. Tell me a bit more about that.
Well, it seemed to us the natural and obvious avenue to try to explore after May the 1st last year. The world was not going to beat a path to my door to employ Mr. Sleaze, as of course I've been dubbed unfairly by the media, and I suppose in a way perhaps the best way to get our own back on the media is to join it. And also, it seems to be one of the professions where happily slurs on one's integrity don't seem to matter too much. Well, I'd like to do serious documentaries.
Kind of over lunchtime.
Of course, that's what I'm most fitted to do by experience and indeed by inclination.
What we need to do is to move across from constantly being interviewed to doing the interviewing. And once the novelty of interviewing us in all the various guises wears off, we've got to make the transition, and that's what we hope to do.
I think I'm a bit too jowly. And you can see the kink in my nose.
Oh, goodness, don't be so vain. I'm a
Which I got when it was broken in Harvey Proctor's shop, you remember.
I do, when you
I was the victim of the gay bashing expedition. Yeah. And there's also that funny little white lump on the side of my eyebrow. We're going to talk about the countryside march which took place last week. Why would you have been on that march if you'd been in the country at the time?
Because I think the country way of life, which is the way it's been phrased, is extremely valuable. It should be sacrosanct, and I think there's a danger in all sorts of small ways, whether it's building on greenfield sites or encroaching on the countryside in that sort of way. I'm terribly sorry, that's my phone again. Or whether it's preserving the rural way of life, which a lot of people don't understand. I mean,
well, when you say preserving the rural way of life, I think, why don't we switch the thing off? We don't want to take calls anyway, so shut it off.
Hello? Yes? Oh, can I ring you back? It's a crashingly inconvenient moment. I'm so sorry.
We can't get a party to Baywatch.
You never know.
Take one for earrings.
Sounds gorgeous, my dear. Gorgeous, my dear.
No, darling, don't scratch it. Little Trot? No, not you.
Come on in, the water's lovely.
Oh, that's a stroke of genius. And what a stunning finish!
Cuprinol exterior wood stains.
Evolution isn't just a theory. It's happening right now. The proof is all around us in the living world. Sometimes family resemblances are buried deep in the genes, just like memory. But sometimes we can trace characteristics from one generation to the next. Improving, evolving, emerging. You could call it genetic engineering.
Sleeker, smarter, more responsive, the new Renault Laguna.
Coming up next, a cracking performance. Polycell Light and Easy Filler. It only takes two ticks.
Before the 1st of May last year, I was Member of Parliament for Waveney, which includes this town of Lowestoft, my hometown. And I have had the privilege of being the MP for 10 years. Well, this is the sports centre. Looks harmless enough now. It's used like this most of the time. But every so often they take all this away and it becomes the counting hall. I seem to think that the Nuremberg criminals were hanged in a gymnasium at the end of the war. And actually the night of the 1st of May felt a bit like that. They built here a platform with steps. First time in my political career they've ever done that. And so it felt like climbing the scaffold to be executed. But the funny thing was that really I thought all along that I would be all right. I thought I'd buck the trend. I thought that my record from being a rebel, standing up for Waveney, I thought that would be enough. And so even when things looked bad on the opinion polls, I thought, ah, but I shall be the exception. Because my slogan all along had been Waveney's own man, made my own mind up on things. And so even as the day approached, and this was coming, this night here, I thought, I'll buck the trend. It wasn't until I walked in with my wife as the count was well progressing and I saw the table stacked here with the ballot papers groaning under the weight of the Labour ballot papers that I knew it was all up.
Blizzard Robert John, the Labour Party, 31,000.
Felt as if we'd suffered a bereavement, as if somebody in the family had died. Of course, somebody in the family had died. I'd died. I suppose immediately after, I felt a certain sense of being kicked in the teeth. I had always put my constituency first, even to the extent of being unpopular with the whips
with some colleagues in the party in London, and I'd always tried to vote absolutely with my conscience. What would my constituents react to this? How would I feel about this piece of legislation? And so I made myself a rebel. But if he cuts the quotas or reduces the fleet at Lowestoft anymore with a ludicrous decommissioning scheme which compensates boat owners but not others who are put on the dole when boats are scrapped, if he cuts by any more than previous years have done, there will be no fishing left. At Lowestoft, a 40% cut means a 100% cut, because the 60% left is unviable. So I say, if he has to come back with a deal which includes cuts, don't come back. If he has to sell us out to get a deal, don't come back. They need us more than we need them. We are answerable to the people of the United Kingdom, not the European Union.
That's the house where I was born, 16 Victoria Terrace, right in the heart of the central area of Lowestoft, old Lowestoft, near the beach, and not far away from the school where I'm currently doing some part-time work. So life is often full of circles, and this is one of them. Coming up now to the east point, the most easterly point of the British Isles. It's called Ness Point because the old name for Lowestoft is Lowestoft Ness. And you've seen the most northerly point, Land's End, John O'Groats. And what we've got here at Lowestoft Ness Point is a gas cylinder. People often say, well, how did you cope? My whole reason to be was just swept away from me, a bit like sea erosion, really. I felt like that, and I felt as if I'd lost my sense of purpose. The thing I'd fought to do for so long was suddenly not mine anymore, and that was hard. What does an ex-MP do? I don't really know. I still don't really know what the role of an ex-MP is.
Well, David was a drama teacher before coming into Parliament. So in many ways, he's been plucked from obscurity. And quite a change, I think, in status. Again, would he want to return to being a teacher? Possibly he would rather do something different. But if he is going to do something different, then he's going to have to retrain. I can't see any way that he would move into business with a CV like this.
I met a young chap called John Hales, like me, local, born and bred, fiercely proud of it. And he's written the script of a film, and he's brought me in to try and help do some of the organisation side. But it's a sort of gangster, modern, black humour film. A bunch of Londoners come and clash with the culture here in this part of the world.
I'm just a bit concerned about the school location. What are they going to do? Well,
the playing field scene is fine, sports day. There's no problem with that at all. It's all arranged, but it's the window.
Right. Plate glass window. Shot from inside. So, right, that's Britain Hall. Yeah?
Right.
There's your corridor.
Yeah.
We'll put the camera in there, and we'll put a camera out there. Leon runs at the window, jumps through the window. We cut to the shot of him jumping through the window there.
Right.
Yeah?
So I'm adding my experience to John's artistic abilities, and together we're a good team, and I think most people wish it well.
Okay, so we take the window out. We replace it with breakable, proper, safe glass. which is going to cost, unless you can work some magic.
Of course, I'm looking to the film be a success so that I can make a living out of that in the future and go on to make other films and live on that. I have very much in mind that if this film is a success, we could make another one, and it could possibly be a story that I've written, a novel that I've written, which people tell me would make a better film than it is a novel, set in this part of the world, East Anglia, in which the European Union has become all-powerful, worse than the Third Reich. And a family here in this part of the world resents what's happening, and it's headed by an old man who used to be an MP.
Are you worried about it failing?
It is a high risk, and of course if it fails, then a lot of my own reputation will go down the plug with it. But to tell you the truth, having had the defeat of the 1st of May last year, I cannot imagine anything worse than that. So if I fail again, then I fail again. And if I have to teach full-time, then I'll teach full-time. I'll do whatever I have to in order to survive, and survive in this world, in this part of the world, with my head held high, supporting my family and my wife.
Well, this is the sunny side of it, really, isn't it?
Yeah, this is the best site in town on a nice day.
Oh, definitely. Well, I mean, if we went, we could always go up there. I mean, it's a lovely shoot. It's just I don't want to kind of miss out on all the kind of. I don't want to paint too rosy a picture of it or something. You know? I mean, we've got to show the good stuff. But we've got to show.
But I mean, that vista there is lovely because it's the old Lowestoft, it's the centre of the tourist occasion. I know we're not making a tourist film.
No.
And so therefore I can understand the point, it's not relevant.
Well, it's great. I mean, any shot that goes down there, because you can just see for bloody miles, look. You can just go forever down there. Well, we're going to turn this place upside down, aren't we, if you think about
it. It should attract a lot of tourist interest, I think, don't you?
Yeah,
because the fact that we're a couple of novices and all the other people working with us, coming into a big area like this and opening it up, it'll be wonderful.
Tell you what, one day all this will be yours.
Instead of having sweet dreams all about you.